Our next presenter, I think, has the distinction of having traveled the furthest to get here. She's in Cody all the way from University of Auckland, New Zealand, where she is currently a lecturer in German. Her research focuses on German, North American, indigenous connections. She's been a Lise Meitner Program Fellow at University of Vienna for her project, Performing Germanness, Reclaiming Aboriginality, which discusses North American indigenous re-examinations of the German Indianer image. And her presentation today is titled The Beginning of a Love Affair, Buffalo Bill in Germany. Nicole.
Thank you. It's great to be back here, and it's been wonderful to see some faces that I know and to meet some new people. So it's been, as it always is in Cody, just an absolute blast. In my paper today, I'll be talking specifically about the German context. Speaking to the mic. Okay. I'll be speaking specifically about the German context, and that is to be understood as the Prussian Empire. I won't be speaking about the Habsburg Empire or the Austrian-Hungarian Empire, but the German-Prussian Empire in the 18th, 19th century. So the German-speaking fascination with the American West and Native American peoples is well documented, and even recently has been enjoying a renewed surge in scholarship. In the German context, the main culprit remains the late 19th century author Karl May and his eponymous Winnetou series. Yet the role and function of the American West and Buffalo Bill's Wild West cannot be underestimated. Karl May was not the first German to write about the West, and similarly, Buffalo Bill Cody was not the first to have toured the German-speaking areas of Europe. But both May and Cody are by far the most popular auteurs of the American West in Germany. While there may be a few similarities between the two men, the American West that each man evoked is markedly different from the other, but not less popular. And both significantly contribute to the phenomenon coined by Hartmut Lutz, known as German Indian enthusiasm, a yearning for all things Indian. The settling of the American West is one of the founding myths of the United States, yet it can also be considered as instrumental in the founding myth of Germany. In the late 18th century, the German nation state was still an idea, a notion being discussed on the literary plane by philosophers and writers. It wasn't until 1871, under Otto von Bismarck, that the nation we know as Germany today was formed. The lack of a political nation state did not prevent an intellectual German interest in America. Although late to the imperialist game, Germany was keenly watching the American expansion west with a vested interest. Their colonies in the South Pacific, South America, and Africa, they used America as the question what to do with indigenous peoples. And it was a significant source of debate in the upper class German households, and the Germans looked to the American West for inspiration. Buffalo Bill's two European tours provided a new and exciting insight into frontier life and indigenous peoples of North America in the late 19th century, and offered a significantly different discourse when compared to the world exhibitions or the Volksschauen, or people shows, made popular in Europe primarily by the German Karl Hagenbach. This paper explores the polemic discourse on indigenous peoples in America from the late 18th to early 20th century Germany. The German myth of the noble savage, and in fact the myth of America, made most famous by Karl May on the literary plane, is confronted with Buffalo Bill's Wild West and his version of the American West during his European tours, are at storytelling odds with one another. However, both men were exceedingly successful financially and as figures in popular culture. Coupled with the mass migration of German citizens to the United States in the 19th century, Buffalo Bill's Wild West remained an avenue for friends and family in Germany to perhaps partly experience the life in America that their relatives and friends were experiencing firsthand. By situating Buffalo Bill's Wild West in a German nationalist discourse, including the formation of the German nation and mass migration to the United States, and perhaps even more remarkable, the power of imagination, I'll highlight the importance and legacy of Buffalo Bill and his Wild West in Germany. Now, the German fascination with Native American peoples is one that's linked to an idea of elective infinities, or Wahlverwandtschaften. To understand the role of the Indianer in German culture, This is Winnetou, based on the Karl May film adaptations, post-war Germany. And this is Pierre Brice, the French actor who portrayed Winnetou. We have to have a clear understanding of the political and social climate that led to this type of historic precedence and to the legacies of the 18th and 19th centuries, which are necessary to the writing and attitudes of these cultural productions, many of which are still in practice today. The noble savage has occupied the minds of Germans and other Europeans for generations, but the concept's genesis in a German context can be traced back to Tacitus and his ethnography of the Germani. Germania, originally written in 98 AD and rediscovered in 1450, is often cited to explain the German affinity towards Native Americans. This starts with Hartmut Lutz, Todd Conchi, H. Glenn Penny, and Julia Settler did this as well. The parallels are convincing. Tacitus sees the Germans as a fierce, warlike people living in an unwelcoming environment, whom he views not as barbarians, but as noble savages. He sees them not as savage, but rather in a more natural state, in contrast to the decadence of Roman civilization. He believes them to be the original inhabitants of the earth, or land, sorry, and cites the harsh climate as the reason why the Germans have remained uncorrupted. For the Germans, it was above all the question of a national identity. In the 18th and 19th centuries, German not only reached back to Tacitus to find their roots, but it also created imagined communities to try to answer their questions of national identity and origins. In the struggle against the 18th century French cultural imperialism, you also had the Russians, the Habsburgs, the British, writers and philosophers tried to define a German nation. And it was on the literary plane that the German identity began to be reformed, or arguably even formed. Within this framework, the image of an affinity towards Native Americans became an important source of identification, and to an extent, even part of the German founding myth. Both Winfried Kriegleder and Oliver Simons have argued that the idea of America in the German consciousness was also first realized through literary sources. Although late to the imperialist race, the Germans had already colonized the libraries of Europe, as Tom Conchi calls them, armchair and colonialists. Beginning in the late 18th century, the idea of colonial expansion was a central topic of debate in Germany. Aware and influenced by both the American and French revolutions and their repercussions, the debates paid close attention to the colonial developments in the young American Republic. The American expansion west was seen as an inspiration for the fledgling German nation to strive for, and consequently the problematic role of indigenous peoples became a topic of interest. The American government and economic progress dictated that the land should be used for agricultural purposes to support the citizens, not exclusively as hunting grounds for the marginal percentage of the population. The reservation system, the American-style settlement policies, the prohibition of mixed-race marriages were practiced in German East Africa and German Samoa. In literature and culture, up until the mid-19th century, indigenous characters had been primarily a stock figure, represented by the noble savage image in the German collective memory. But this began to change as large-scale emigration was transforming the face of Germany, and America was one of the most popular destinations. The greatest influx of German emigration occurred between 1820 and 1914, with approximately 6 million Germans emigrating to America. So this is a slide taken from an article in The Economist in 2015, which looked at the influence of Germans in America. And it should be pointed out that before the First World War, German was most likely the second most spoken language in America. Where was it? I lost my spot. In literature culture up to that, I did that already. Stories depicting the German experience in America were becoming increasingly popular, with a series of German travel writers and novelists building on the German curiosity of the young American Republic. And by the 1830s, one of the most read books was a translation of James Fenimore Cooper's The Last of the Mohicans. But as colonial attitudes and travel to America increased, the German image of indigenous people shifted to that of an ignoble savage. And this was perpetrated mainly by authors like Friedrich Gerstacker, who had a very negative image of Native American peoples in Arkansas. In his extreme form, advocating for the assimilation and even extinction of indigenous peoples under the guise of westward expansion by the dominant and technologically more advanced American Republic. Back in Germany, with the formation of the nation state and the rise of the urban population and industrialization, there was a creation of mass leisure time and commercial entertainment in city centers. With the popularity of the world exhibitions and the Volksschauen, the Indiana image began to shift again, and German author Karl May's eponymous character Winnetou came to represent at the same time the German ideal of the Indiana, but also the inevitable demise of an entire people. Mai created a legendary German-influenced figure that has come to represent not only the dying man, but also the imagined kinship between two distinct cultures, whose popularity can still be seen today. From American hobbyism, which we saw in the first slide in its extreme form, to the Karl May Festspiele, to the films that I mentioned earlier, and to the highest grossing German film of all time, Der Schuh des Manitou, a parody of the Indiana Filme, and who said Germans don't have a sense of humor, eh? And the newly adapted Winnetou films, 2016. This is our Winnetou. He is now from Albania originally. The Indiana has never been far from the surface. Peter Boltz perhaps summarizes the German affinity best. Wherever German is spoken, Winnetou has become a synonym for the Indian, and when the press speaks of Winnetou's brothers and sisters, everyone knows that the Indians of North America are meant. And Mai was by no means the first German to write about indigenous peoples, but what Mai did was create a German fantasy of the American West. In 1893, Mai published a three-volume series based on the American West, centered around the German immigrant, Old Shatterhand, and his Apache blood brother, Winnetou. The series was wildly popular, with 400,000 volumes being published by 1896. He's also still the most published German author ever. The only thing that beats him is the Luther Bible. Mai combined the fascination with America and its Native American population with a German cultural narrative and created the most famous German Western ever, with his influence still resonating again even today. Mai gives Winnetou and the Apache a decidedly European countenance. Described as noble, their features are Roman and not deemed as characteristically Indian as the other tribes such as the Kiowa present in the narrative. And their demeanor seems to be a bit more sophisticated and educated, primarily due to their acceptance of the German interloper Kalaki Petra, who has converted the majority of them to Christianity. Even their skin tones are not described as red, but rather light brown or bronze. Mai sets the Germans up as a morally superior people, especially to the land-grabbing Yankees, and thus reinforces the idea of a blood brotherhood between the two archetypes of indigenous and white cultures. In creating an overly masculine adventure narrative that favors discussion and understanding over violence as a response to potentially explosive situations, Mai teaches the reader that it is a strong belief in Christianity, hard work and discipline that Old Shatterhand garners so much fame and respect. Winnetou remains the epitome of the noble savage in Germany, and of course converts to Christianity while dying in Old Shatterhand's lap. But he is also widely considered an Apfel Indiana, red on the outside, white on the inside. Hartmut Lutz writes in more detail. Since Winnetou is a stereotype, an empty cliche without Indian content or identity, his only use here is as a vehicle for white, here German ideology. Winnetou, the red gentleman, upon further reflection, turns out to be nothing but a petit bourgeois German in Indian costume, end quote. The portrayal of Winnetou and the interplay of indigenous, German, and Yankee cultures in the Mai text supports the idea of the Germans as better, more humane colonizers than the Yankees at a time when Germany had an active interest in their colonies and non-European peoples. Mai owes much to the World Exhibition's Völkerschauen and, of course, Buffalo Bill's Wild West. The Völkerschauen in particular brought non-European, exotic peoples to zoos in Germany and other parts of Europe and visually stimulated the debate and discourse surrounding non-European peoples, something we've touched upon yesterday and consistently through this conference. More often than not, the performers traveling the shows were doing so willingly and positively in order to earn money to bring home and to travel and see Europe. The tragic case of the Inuk Abraham Ulrikap and his family is an exception and something we can discuss later, or we can discuss right now. So what happened was they were brought over from Labrador, and they weren't inoculated against smallpox. The person bringing them over got sick and ill, and that part of the process was missed, and they died, unfortunately, all in Europe or Germany at that time, in France or Germany at that time. What's interesting about Abraham, he wrote a journal about his experiences, commenting on the Germans and the French people. Karl Hagenbach is one of the best known purveyors of the Völkerschauen, and around 1887, he begins to limit and eventually completely stop running the shows until he began again when the shows reached their prime in 1907 to 1913. Reasons such as charlatans, bogus shows, and a general decline in interest have been cited, but Eric Ames points to a different reason, Buffalo Bill. quote, in voicing their enthusiasm for the Wild West, spectators help redefine the terms of ethnographic exhibition, albeit inadvertently. If science and authenticity were of serious concern to the German audience, then myth and fantasy were far more inspirational, end quote. The myth and fantasy, and I would argue along with the inspiration, be it of the German or American West, are the essential commodities that both Mai and Buffalo Bill used in selling their versions of the West to the German audience. It's worthwhile to note that if it wasn't until the Wild West shows in Germany that the mythical and permeating image of the Plains Indian, one that Carl Mai benefited from, began to take hold. Buffalo Bill's Wild West was a show that captivated the audience with historical scenes of the Wild West being played out before the audiences. It was the authenticity that the show and Buffalo Bill, as a true man of the West, was able to trade on and that led to their popularity. But paradoxically, it was their ability to bring the fiction of early German writers, such as Gestecke and even Cooper, to life that led to the specific German fantasy of the Wild West, that their childhood dreams could come true. Buffalo Bill's Wild West contributed directly to the popularity of Carl Mai's imagined German America, as you could argue that Mai's stories simply added a specific German content to Buffalo Bill's. By all accounts, the men never met, although there could have been the possibility of it, or that Mai at least had seen a performance in Dresden in 1890. As my biographer Helmut Schmid quite rightly posits, if Mai wanted to be able to compete with the commercially successful Buffalo Bill, an authentic man of the West, he would have to also physically assume the role of Old Shatterhand, his German man of the West, and he of course had no qualms doing so. And this comes back to what we saw in the previous presentation with Oscar Wilde and Buffalo Bill. Cody's costume was the inspiration of Mai's Old Shatterhand outfit in which he was continually photographed. Mai never visited the Wild West. The Wild West he created, he only visited America once, and that was to upstate New York. But his version of the Wild West, along with Buffalo Bill's, both continually contributed significantly to the German fantasy and the understanding of the West, and broadly speaking, America, where a man could pull himself up by his bootstraps and through both ambition and drive have his dreams come true. For many Germans, Buffalo Bill was a living embodiment of that dream. Thank you.